Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. In the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, most gracious, most merciful. Alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillahi wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. We praise the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who created us, the one who nourishes, cherishes, provides, protects, the one who cures, the one who is in absolute control of every aspect of our existence. We praise him, we send blessings and salutations upon all the messengers of the Almighty, those who were sent to us as a gift in order to remove us from the darkness and take us into the light. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless them all. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his companions, household, and may Allah bless every one of you. May Allah alleviate the suffering you may be going through. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant you cure from the diseases you may be having or the sicknesses you may not be knowing that you have. May Allah grant you good health and may Allah grant you blessings in your wealth, in your families. May Allah grant you blessings in your health, your wealth, your families, and in your entire existence. Ameen. MashaAllah, that was quite loud. Alhamdulillah. Normally the response is quite low, but when I decided to make a dua for you, it started getting louder and louder. MashaAllah. May Allah bless us truly. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all goodness. Ameen. Ameen. My brothers, my sisters, I want to remind you that life is not longer than 70 years on average. The hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, أَعْمَارُ أُمَّتِي مَا بَيْنَ السِّتِّينَ إِلَى السَّبْعِينَ. The average lifespan of the members of my ummah, meaning you and I, us, our generations nowadays, is between 60 and 70 years. That's the average. Some places it's less, some places it's a little bit more, but this is the average. So if we take a look at that amount of time, it is very, very little. It is so little, subhanallah, very little. Whereas the day of judgment will be so long. The day of judgment will be so long. Allah describes it by saying, خَمْسِينَ أَلْفَ سَنَةً. The one day will be equivalent to 50,000 years of the years of this worldly life. Which means if you were to divide, do a little bit of division, you'll realize that 70 years of our lives is actually a minute or two of the day of judgment. Not even, it's even less. And if you were to look at the days of the hereafter, after the day of judgment, so we have our days made up of 24 hours, and then we have the day of judgment made up of 50,000 years of the 24 hours that we have, and then we have after the day of judgment, when people go into the hereafter, the Quran says, وَإِنَّ يَوْمًا عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ كَأَلْفِ سَنَةٍ مِّمَّا تَعُدُّونَ. Indeed, the days with your Lord, here speaking of that after the day of judgment, are equivalent to 1,000 years of what you count, of your year, of your subhanallah years. Al-fasanatin, one day equivalent to 1,000 years of yours. So our lifespan would be a small fraction of 50,000 or a fraction of 1,000. It's nothing, it's not much, very little. I'm on earth for such a short space of time. That itself proves that you are on a mission. You are on a mission. So go back to find out what the mission is. You find in Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah tells the angels in the Quran, وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. Remember when Allah told the angels that I am going to place on earth a khalifa. What's the meaning of khalifa? One of the meanings of the term is those who come one after the other. Those who come one after the other. So when Adam alayhi salam, the first of humankind, came, he did not live forever. He lived for his period of time, and after that he passed away and others lived. And when they were born, they were obviously requiring attention far greater than when they grew up a little bit, and thereafter they too grew older and passed away, leaving behind others who then continued, and so on. And so on, until it came to us. So the plan of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is, you will be born, there will be a space of time for you to grow up, then there will be a space of time at your peak, and then there will be a space of time when it will be beyond that. You will start preparing for the next generation. That is very interesting. Let's go into the Quran. We find in Surah Ar-Rum, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
Allahu alladhi khalaqakum min da'fin thumma ja'ala min ba'di da'fin quwwah thumma ja'ala min ba'di quwwatin da'fan wa shaybah.
Allah has created man in weakness. When you were born, you were weak. You were so weak, you required the attention of those around you. Had they not attended to you, you would have not survived. Reality. So Allah created you in weakness. And after that, He let you get to a stage of strength. The peak, you all know the peak, when you feel, subhanallah, strong and energetic and no pains, no health matters, nothing. And after that, Allah says, after that energetic period of strength, we then dropped man. You know, when he got to the top of the mountain, we dropped him down once again, and he grew gray hair and at the same time became weak once again. So divide your life into three, say 60 years. If 60 years are divided into three, just on average, we are not going to use precise amount of years because each one differs. We're just using an average. 60 divided by 3, 20. Did you know, and this is something very interesting, very important. Did you know, for the first 20 years of your life, your parents are taking care of you and they are looking after you. You are growing up. The second 20 years of your life, you are living your life. The third 20 years of your life, you are preparing for others to live their life. Let's say that again. The first 20 years of your life, someone is preparing you to live your life. Right? The second 20 years of your life, you are living your life. The third 20 years of your life, you are preparing someone else to live their life. Then you leave. That's it. Have you thought of it that way? So in essence, how many years did you actually live your life? 20 years, that's it. Approximately, because the first 20 years you couldn't really do much. You had to do what your parents said, and then you grew a little bit older and you were struggling to find yourself. You learned this and you learned that. Nowadays they try to keep us in school and college until we get to 40. They try, because now you're a cabbage, you come out and that's it, over, life is finished. And the kids want to start their lives at 12, 13. When my daughter was 9, she was almost taller than me. And when she reached 12, she was much taller than me. Subhanallah. And I'm looking and saying, 12 years old. Subhanallah, 12. I used to tease her saying, are you putting fertilizer in your shoes? But that's what's happening. I don't know if it's Kellogg's or genetically modified food or what's going on. Subhanallah. But that's a reality. But at 20, mashallah, you get married and so on. You're living your life. Before you know it, you have babies. You have children. May Allah bless those who do not have children with children. And I want to pause for a moment to honor them. those who don't have children, I need to pause for a moment to honor them. Let me tell you why. Allah has perhaps chosen for you something far greater. Allah knows something that you don't know, so He's given you your gift that is different. Maybe He wants to use you to serve in a different way. Perhaps He wants you to earn paradise through bearing the patience. And you will continue trying, there's no harm in trying, and you will continue praying. We learnt about Zakariya alayhi salam when he told Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, "Oh Allah, I'd love to have offspring. Bless me with the offspring." He kept calling out to Allah. Allah gave him at a certain stage. So don't lose hope. When we talk about children, we do have the back of our minds, in the back of our minds, the fact that there are some and a growing number who don't have children. May Allah bless you with children. May Allah bless you with those who will be the coolness of your eyes. Say Ameen on behalf of those. Ameen. So Subhanallah, you have children just after 20 something, I hope, inshallah. Maybe 30, you know, I told you yesterday that I'm about to be a grandfather. Didn't I say that? Mashallah. And I wasn't lying, subhanallah. I wasn't lying. I started off very early, mashallah. We were the impatient lot by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us and grant us guidance and ease. So I wasn't lying. It doesn't make me old in terms of figures, but it makes me old in terms of title, mashallah. In terms of title, you know. So getting back to what we are saying, you clock 40. At 40, what's happening? You're busy looking after children, young ones. They're growing, perhaps adolescent, maybe in their teens if you're lucky. And what happens is you're now preparing them. You're trying. People are earning. When they earn, you ask them, "What are you earning for?" They will all tell you, "We're earning because we would like our children to have a comfortable life." That's what they say. That's what they say. Don't worry, your children come with their sustenance. They come with their own, given from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But mashallah, it's noble that you're trying. While you are trying, don't do that which is prohibited in order to try and set your children or settle them. Make sure it is legal in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So then there comes a time when you are ready to leave. But if I were to ask those who are 60 years old here in this gathering, "Are you ready to leave?" they will say no. If I were to ask 70 years, "You ready to leave?" no. 80 years, "You ready to leave?" no. 100 years, "You ready to leave?" no. Who wants to leave? Nobody. Subhanallah. But Allah says, "You were in a better place before you came here, and you will be in a much better place after you leave." It's my plan that you need to go. You have to go. Sometimes, and you will agree with me, sometimes we lead our lives in such a way. Okay, let me not say we, because we're still a bit young, right? Sometimes the older people carry on in such a way that some young people are forced to say, "Oh Allah, when's this man gonna go? Oh Allah, when is she going to go? You know what she's been doing in this household? She's running amok." They always said Muslims were terrorists. I found one. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. But people actually pray for the death of their parents. Did you ever know that? May Allah not... Oh, the year was very loud in Guyana. I won't forget that. Astaghfirullah. Astaghfirullah. Okay. People actually pray for the death of some others who are a little bit older because they become problematic. And this is why we say sometimes when there is a generation gap, you know, before a generation gap used to be 40 years. Now it's just a few years. There's a big generation gap. Because if you cannot use Instagram, Snapchat, Telegram, WhatsApp, Facebook and everything all at once, you belong to the 60s. You belong to the 60s. That's what the kids say. That's what the kids say. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. Amen. You know, I had a case where I was dealing with a young boy. And he happened to speak about his parents. And his parents are roughly my age, okay? And he says, "You know, my parents, they belong to the 90s. And I'm like, "They actually do, you know that? They actually do, and guess what? I do too." May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. So it's important for us to realize the gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah's plan is such that we have to go. Inshallah, we will be going to a better place. But before we go, there is a mission we need to accomplish. What is it? That's what I want to spend the next 30 minutes speaking about. The mission is to learn, to put into practice, and to reach out to others with what you've learned. What do you learn? You've got to learn everything there is to learn. When you're young, you learn a lot from your parents, from those whom you are around. And this is why those who are parents, please have meals with your children, because table manners is something you will teach your children. A lot of us, we don't know how to eat ourselves. Munch anything and everything as it comes. No discipline in food. Eat the sweetest, the tastiest of food. Not thinking about whether it's healthy. You know, my dad used to always tell us, I know when I was growing up and I didn't like the eggplant. And he says, you're becoming a hafiz. If you want your memory to really be top, you've got to eat this. And I believed it. I actually believed it, and religiously I used to eat it, and that day I used to think I did better than the previous day. But that was his way of telling me, subhanAllah, appreciate the gifts of Allah. You've got to eat it. Whatever your mom cooks, have it. So we used to eat. And sometimes, you know, I'm not ashamed to say, sometimes we used to have the same food for a while. SubhanAllah. Our children are luckier than us, but they are less grateful. They are less content. When we were young, we used to get hand-me-downs. You know what those are? The shoes I wore, I used to suspect my grandfather having worn them. Meaning, the shoes I wore, I used to know they've come from my brother, they've come from another brother, and so on. By the way, we were 9, subhanAllah. Well, I was competing with my dad, so I'm sitting at 8, alhamdulillah. 8 of my own children, alhamdulillah. Say mashallah, tabarakallah. So, it's amazing how now talk about hand-me-downs and see what the children do. SubhanAllah, hand-me-down? More like hand-me-up. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us and our children. And may we be guided. They have much more in terms of material wealth. Most of us seated here, our parents probably were struggling. They were struggling to pay our school fees, I promise you. And if not our parents, our grandparents. Some of them perhaps didn't really have shoes. Like I said earlier, the clothing, we shared it, we were so proud. There are people who still do this. But times have changed. The majority, no way. We'll throw away part of our food while we're eating just because we didn't like the taste. Whereas when we were younger, forget the taste. That's food, man. SubhanAllah, it's food. You know, close your nose and eat it. Because that's what it's supposed to do to you. It's supposed to give you the nutrients needed. No, so going back to this responsibility we have. Have a meal with your children. Have more than one meal. You are fortunate. You are in Guyana. Guyana's not such a fast life that in order to get to work, it takes you 3 hours, and to come back from work, it takes you another 3 hours. And you know, you're working from morning to evening. You cannot see your children. Some of the first world countries, that's their life. But with us, we're fortunate. We can come back from work in 10 minutes. We can have a meal with our kids, read our salah, and wash up and go back. And we're still in time, 5 to 2, we're back at work. It can happen. It happens in my country, Zimbabwe. And I'm sure it can happen here as well. I've seen the place. Today I told some people, I think it's very similar to Zimbabwe. There's not much in terms of difference, besides the broccoli that I spoke about yesterday. And by the way, on Instagram, you might have noticed, I actually put that broccoli that we took a picture of from the air. You know, I told you as we were coming in, I was wondering, there's so much broccoli in Guyana. When we came a little bit closer, we noticed, no, this is the Amazon, man. SubhanAllah. And I've put that video up. I'm not lying. It's on Instagram. Go and check it. So it's amazing. We have so many different types of food, but our children are still not grateful. Do you know why? We haven't taught them gratitude. That's why. So one might say, I try. Wait, do you have a meal with them? Do you read your dua aloud before the meal so that they can follow you? Do you actually read your supplication? Do you thank the Almighty for the meal before it and after it? Do you actually do that? No, you don't. Let's be honest. I'm guilty sometimes myself. Let's be honest. We can do better. When the next time you put something to your mouth, say Bismillah aloud. Why aloud? So that your children can follow you. Those around you can be reminded, Bismillah. You said the name of Allah. You are eating, thanking Allah for what you have. And then while you're eating, say, MashaAllah, this is the gift of Allah. There are people who don't have food, they don't have drink, and Alhamdulillah, this is it. The problem is, we are already beyond our 20 years, and we are fighting to eat out every other day. So when the children see you cooking, mother or father, I'm not saying who should cook, because just now Sheikh Muslih might throw an egg on me from the back. But wherever and whoever cooks, do it with a smile. When your kids see that happening, they will enjoy cooking. But when we're cooking, it's so sad, it's so bad, it's something, it's a chore, it's something very bad. Your kids will never want to cook. And this is a fact, there was an arbitration that I was involved in. And the issue was around laziness. The wife is saying the husband is lazy, and the husband is saying the wife is lazy. The husband is saying it's the wife's duty to cook, and the wife is saying it's the husband's duty to cook. You know what I said? I said, okay, you guys can live, and you can eat, drink, and breathe fresh air. Someone has to cook, come on! And you guys are not wealthy enough to get Intercontinental to come and cook every day. Someone has to cook. So, I don't care, sort it out between yourselves, but do it with a smile. Come on. You cannot remain on WhatsApp and think that those fresh vegetables and cakes that appear on your screen would actually pop up into your mouth. They don't. Those are emojis, by the way. Emoticons, by the way. The burger looks quite nice, actually. Make one just like that. Eat the real thing. You'll solve so many problems. We always say people actually put these hearts and these kisses and these beautiful faces, but in real life they're sitting there sulking. A few years ago, I got wind of that when people started using LOL, and they don't even laugh. All of us, including myself, were guilty of that. LOL, you haven't laughed. LOL. When I went to the UK, wallahi, with these ears, while there were these people talking, I heard this one girl saying, lol. I heard her saying, lol. And I'm wondering, what happened? And the other one says, lol. And I'm like, they actually don't laugh anymore. They just say, lol. They say it, lol. So now we are laughing. But I'm sure if you went to a first world country, they've got no time to laugh sometimes. They just say, lol. So when we say something funny, everyone says, oh, I wonder what it'll sound like in this hall. But that's what we've reduced our relationships to. It's got to do with an abbreviation. Our life has become an abbreviation. Extended. Abbreviations are dangerous. This afternoon, someone was telling me, you know, regarding halal food, we were talking about halal. And the guy says, you know, there was someone who walked into a restaurant and he saw it said there halal. He looked at it and he actually went in and ate things that were looking like pork and looking like bacon and everything. He just swiped whatever because he saw halal. When he went out, he says, what was that? The guy says, that was bacon. This was pork. But you have halal. He says, no, the manager's name is H.A. Lau. That's what abbreviations do to you, my brothers and sisters. They make you consume the pork and the bacon. You better be careful. You've got to know how to read things. You've got to see things. You've got to make sure that everything is well. And don't be trapped by H.A. Love. My brothers and sisters, when you're cooking a meal, make sure your expression is such that you pass the baton on to the next generation. They learn from you that it is an honor to feed my spouse. It is an honor to feed my children. It is an honor. I do it with a smile. I know when to put my phone away. I know when to say no to something. I know the limit of something, and so on. You know, we have a problem of people who think, and to be honest, I'm going to say this because we face this problem back where I come from as well, where sometimes we use religion where it suits us. And so we tell the women, it's an act of worship to cook, you know. So she's busy like Taraweeh in the kitchen. It's like she's going on and on. I mean, if it's equivalent to units of prayer, she must have made 60 units already. Subhanallah. And you're just saying, it's an act of worship. Blackmailing her. Subhanallah. You don't spend your entire day there. Set a time. I'm there for 1 hour. Whatever comes out, comes out. Subhanallah. If it's scrambled eggs, that's it. We'll scramble for them. But you don't say, spend your whole day there. No, you have to increase your acts of worship to Allah, your tilawa of the Quran, you've got to improve your knowledge. You've got to expand. You may have to, in some cases, work. You may have to do things. You have other responsibilities. Your duty and responsibility is not only one thing. So I always say, you know, yes, you may cook. And yes, you should, because someone, somewhere, somehow has to cook, because we have to all eat. So we have to do that. But you need to set aside the time. Set aside a time. You don't have to waste time there. Some people enjoy it. Alhamdulillah, no problem. Read your adhkar, please, while you're cooking, inshallah. At least your food won't be burnt. My brothers and sisters, the point I'm raising, when our children see us do the important things with a smile, wallahi, they will get used to that. We don't pray sometimes. And when we pray, it's a chore. It's a problem. We keep it to the last minute and then we're rushing. They will let it click beyond the last minute and say, oh no, qada, if you're lucky. Some people don't even breathe qada. So if salah is so beautiful in your heart and the prayer is so important to you, and whenever you pray and turn towards your maker, you have a smile, you are dressed appropriately, you look fresh and you're okay, trust me, you're passing the baton on in the correct way. You follow? When you've got to read the Quran, pick it up, read aloud in the morning, even if it's 10 minutes. Your children will say, my mother never ever left the 10 minutes of prayer in the morning. Never. They will emulate, they will follow, sometimes even after your death. But they know, you set the example. Why I say this? It's connected to what I started with. The 20 years, then the 20, and then the 20. Average. We were given the torch by our parents. We are now consolidating what we have, the next 20, living our lives, and the last 20, we are handing the torch over to the next generation. And then we leave with a smile. You have responsibilities, your character, your conduct. The way we treat non-Muslims, those who are not Muslims, how we treat them sometimes is ridiculous. It's not an Islamic teaching. Sometimes the way we behave with the non-Muslims is so bad because we don't acknowledge them, we don't reach out to them, we're not kind to them, we have a bad expression on our faces, and we expect them to think Islam is a beautiful religion. They look at us as snobs. It happens. Go out of your way to make sure your expression as an act of worship is brilliant. I said it yesterday. I'm repeating it because of the importance of it. Wallahi. If you're sitting, like even now, if you're sitting, become conscious of your expression. Become conscious of it. Think to yourself, how am I sitting? You know, if you frown all the time, you start developing these lines at an early age, you know, in your on your face, because you're sitting like this. Have you ever seen a bulldog? Yeah, that's what happens. And you start looking like that. But if you constantly have a face that has a slight smile or a decent expression, it's pleasant for people to interact with you. No matter how many problems they have, they look at you, they start smiling, they forget their problems. They forget their issues. Why? You've got a decent expression on your face. It's one of the secrets of leadership, by the way, to have a good expression. Well, we're leading in our own homes. Like I said, how we treat and reach out to the non-Muslims. You need to be upright and honest. We are not honest amongst ourselves. We're crooking ourselves and cheating in business. How? How and why? Amongst ourselves, we have problems and issues we don't resolve. Our children are watching. Life is about give and take. I'm not saying compromise your principles, but learn to give and take as far as you can. It doesn't have to be your way all the time. Your children are watching. If you teach your children that it has to be your way all the time because you were very stubborn in life, then trust me, they're going to be worse than that. Worse. Because you're passing them a wrong torch. You're passing them a candle that's going to burn the whole house. So my brothers and sisters, we need to improve on this in a tremendous way. The way we look at things. When you go to work in the morning, mashallah, you're dressed, you're so happy, you're excited, yeah, you're gone. Alhamdulillah. You come back, what happens? You need to be even more excited to get back to your home. You need to show that these are my family members, they're important. You will have differences in the home, but you need to respect. Let me spend a moment speaking about in-laws, either way. Daughter-in-law, mother-in-law, son-in-law, father-in-law, in-laws, whatever it is, you are all connected somehow. You just need to respect each other. And if one makes a mistake, you cannot say, right, tit for tat, I'm going to fix. Fix what? You might want to sort the matter out in a good way. But how you deal with it can actually resolve it without even talking about it sometimes. Have a good relationship. Why is it that we're facing so many splits in the ummah that every community, every masjid, every society, every home, within every person, there is a problem? We're confused because we've lost direction. That's what it is. We need to go back to the life of the most blessed Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Take a look at his characteristics. How he spoiled his family members. When I say spoiled, I mean it in a good way. I mean he took care of them. He made sure that they were acknowledged. He did not embarrass them in the public. Like what we would do sometimes with our own children and family members in the mall. We make a scene. I remember I was on an aircraft and there was a baby yelling and screaming, yelling. And I actually got up and went to the mother. You can imagine, you can picture it now. I got up and I went to the mother, who was not too far. And I said, sister, I have something to tell you. She was expecting me to say something. Keep those kids quiet. Keep those kids quiet. That's not what I would have said. I said, sister, a child will cry, but everyone will watch how you react to the child. So just be calm. She was lost for words. Did you hear what I said? The child will cry. I wouldn't mind if children cried here, but I would watch your reaction. If you kept on spanking them, say, cry more, let him end his talk, cry more, let him, then I know. If you notice yesterday, someone was crying, and that depicted me saying, wa sallallahu wa sallama wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad, and I went away, because my time was up as well. And I don't doubt at all that the child was innocent, mashallah. But I'm just giving you an example. So the children will cry how you reacted to that. I've seen people in a mall dressed tip-top, you know, dressed in a proper way, very smart. They have their children crying, and I have seen some people whack their children unacceptably. If it was in a country where they had stricter rules, the parents would have been jailed. And I've seen it and I had to intervene. What's going on here? Don't do that. People watch you. Let the children will cry. They'll keep. And you have a few people slightly older who cannot tolerate kids sometimes. They might look back at you, give you a dirty look. So what? So what? Let them give you a dirty look. You know, smile back. I love doing that. I love it. You know, people look at you, they give you a dirty look and just say, that's it. They don't know what to do after that. It's a reaction. If you give them another dirty look, it makes two dirty people. Why do you do that? Give them a clean look. Show them you use Colgate, mashallah. You know, I might be wording this lightly, but wallahi, these are very serious points. You know, I might be wording this in a light way, but that's my method. It's my way of talking. The points I'm raising are extremely important. You need to learn to respect one another in the home. You need to learn to respect one another at work, in the masjid, wherever you go, even in a Muslim Islamic organization, even with the non-Muslims. You need to learn to respect one another. You are human beings. Imagine if we didn't respect one another on the roads, what would happen? There would be chaos. And like I say, your children are watching. Everything you do, you're preparing the next generation. You know it or don't know it, you're handing the baton, you're giving the torch, you're giving the candle. Make sure it is lit well. Make sure the batteries of that torch are the real proper ones. Make sure that the baton is given properly. You know, when you're running the relay, that's exactly what happens. The baton is given to the next person. If it's dropped, he has to come back, collect it, and then go. So give the baton properly. That's one of the most important points. You know, you can be the best 100 meter runner in the world and your team can be the best, but you can be disqualified if there is a problem with one person. It happened recently. One person, there was a problem with, the others lost their medal. Subhanallah. Same applies with us. We're passing the baton. Let there not be a problem with us, lest we are to blame for the failure of the others. So this is why I said it's important for us to be inspired to do things with a smile. Your duty, your responsibility. When you get back home, my brothers, my sisters, after a difficult day of work, it's not easy to put a smile on your face. But if you don't do that, who is going to do that? If you don't show enthusiasm, who is going to do it? If you don't help with the serving of the food, who's going to do that? A lot of the homes today are like restaurants. Father comes, he just looks in, takes the food, warms it, he's eating on his own. Little while later, mother comes, she's taking her little burger or whatever else it is, warm it and eat it, and that's it. The children come one after the other. Who ate together? Who sat together? Where is the meal? Where is the learning that takes place on the table? The table manners and the speech that happens there is worth thousands of dollars. I promise you, thousands of dollars. To be able to sit, look at each other, smile. Wallahi, that is priceless. Priceless. If you as a mother looked at your daughter, your son, or you as a father happened to look at your children or your parents, even though they may be older, or your spouse, and you just looked at them as you were eating and you smiled, a genuine smile, that is priceless. Priceless. That is something we lack. Expressions. We're guilty. From today, I want you all, myself included, become more conscious of your expressions. They will solve, or that will solve, a lot of your problems. Your expression on your face, no matter what, even if you're sad or upset, try to have a decent expression and explain to those around you what is going on so that they know why that expression is not like it should be. That's very important, communication. Sometimes, you know, someone is sulking, and this happens a lot, by the way. Someone is sulking, and when you happen to say, what's wrong? No, nothing wrong. But what's wrong? No, nothing. Well, why are you sulking? I'm not. You're going to cause a problem just now, because you know what? You need to communicate. Say, you know, something's bothering me, but I'll talk to you about it later. At least, that's good enough. I know now why you're sad. And if someone really loves you, they will pester you until you tell them what's going on. That's a sign of love, sign of care. And as soon as you tell them what's going on, they start yelling sometimes because they don't know how to deal with it. That's not a sign of care. That's a sign of immaturity. You have to listen. People's feelings, listen to what they have to say. They have feelings. And when you listen, don't just react immediately in a negative way. Digest it. Think about it. Today I was telling someone, you know what? With your husband, and between the two of you, learn to apologize sometimes, even if you're not wrong. If by saying I'm sorry, It's going to solve the problem between husband and wife. Either of you or both of you can say that. What's wrong? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for us. The reason why I say this is because we will have lived our lives in a beautiful way, and when you live your life in a beautiful way, you're automatically passing the baton on to your children, to the next generation. You are fulfilling the whole purpose of your existence, and that is to pass the baton. Khalifa. You are. Those who yell and scream in their homes, if you were to marry their daughter, trust me, you will probably get yelling and screaming in your home. So be careful. Or if it was a son, that's what's going to happen. If there is a man who constantly beats up his, astaghfirullah, but it's happening, who abuses his wife, and you are to marry the son of that person, unless you know that they are very different, you will start finding similar traits and you start getting frightened. Oh, no way, no way. Look what's going on. You know, when the goat was small, there were no horns. And now suddenly, the horns are appearing. You seen that? And then they grow. And they start using them to fight. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not let that happen to us. But that's what we do. The horns are growing and then they start using them. They attack me, but I'm the one who used to rub the head every day. Allahu Akbar. My brothers and sisters, it's very, very important, extremely important that we develop our character. I tell you why. The hadith of the Prophet ﷺ says, Khayrukum. Khayrukum is used to refer to the best of you. And in some narrations, he says, Khiyarukum. Khiyarukum means the best from amongst you. So you find one day he said, Khayrukum, Khayrukum li ahlihi. The best from amongst you, those who are best to your family members, beginning with your wife. That's what he says. The best from amongst you are those who are best to their wives. It also means those who are best to their husbands, those who are best to their family members, because that could be included in the term ahl. But I want to tell you, in another narration, he says, خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ تَعَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنَ وَعَلَّمَهُ. The best from amongst you, those who learn the Quran and teach it. So one might say, there is a contradiction between the two. There is no contradiction. If you learn the Quran thoroughly, you will be the best to your spouse because your character will improve. In another narration, he says, خِيَارُكُمْ أَحَاسِنُكُمْ أَخْلَاقًا. The best from amongst you are those who have the best character. Look how the three are connected. They are all connected. If you have the best character, you will be the best to your spouse. If you have the Quran, you are learning it and teaching it genuinely, you will be the best of character. Because when Aisha radiallahu anha was asked about the character of the Prophet, peace be upon him, she said, Kana khuluquhu al-Quran. His character was the Quran. So there is a connection between character being the Quran, character being the best to the spouse, and character being the best all round. There is a connection and a link between all of these. So this is why we say you've got to learn to be the best. This is why character is so important. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam stressed about character to the degree that, subhanallah, he even said that a person would enter paradise due to his character and conduct. The companions were asked a question by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In fact, he was asked. The Prophet, peace be upon him, was asked a question that, O Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which are the characteristics of those who would enter paradise? The majority of the people in paradise, what would have taken them there? Do you know what he said? Taqwallahi wa husnul khuluqi. Two things. He says, the consciousness of their maker. They were conscious of their maker. They were people, righteous people. And the second characteristic. So one of the characteristics that will take people to heaven will be taqwallahi. People who have taqwa, people who have got consciousness, people who are righteous. And the second one is husnul khuluq. Those who have great character and conduct. They will get into paradise. When you go to paradise, you find the people. Oh, this one was taqwallah. This one husnul khuluq. This one a combination of both of them. And generally, when you have taqwallah, automatically you will develop husnul khuluq. Do you know what I want to tell you? When you pray, when you cover yourself, when you look very pious and religious, it does not mean you are. I tell you why. Because what shows that you are truly pious is your character, how you treat others, that's what shows. So if a man is fulfilling his prayer in the first saf, but his mouth is foul, he lies, he has a temper, he treats his family very badly, trust me, there is something wrong with that prayer of his. It's just a show, that's what it is. And we've dealt with cases in the past where someone you really think is, you know, on a very high level, and the wife tells you, this man beats me blue. I've got medical reports to prove that this man beats me green and blue. And you say, which man? This man. But that's the guy in the first saf. Yes, that's the man. No, I can't. You see, you wouldn't even believe it. I have a video of it. Okay, I don't need to see the video. I don't need to see the video. And you're shocked. Shocked. This man. That's not piety. Closeness to the Almighty shows in your character and your conduct. When you are close to the Almighty, your character improves automatically. So, if your character is not good, you cannot be close to the Almighty because you haven't understood that the rest of the creatures are the creatures of the same Almighty. So, my brothers and sisters, I call on you to develop both. Develop your link with Allah, with your Maker, and fulfill the rights of people through good character and conduct. Make sure that this happens. Do you believe I've spoken for 45 minutes?
No.
Subhanallah, well I have. And I don't wish to continue further, inshallah. Hope to come back to Guyana sometime, inshallah, to continue this beautiful discussion. I know I may have worded it in a very light way, but trust me, the lessons are extremely important for all of us. My brothers and sisters, it's about time we smiled more, inshallah, to one another. It's about time we greeted each other. It's about time we acknowledged each other. It's about time we spoke to the rest of humankind with respect. And inshallah, you find you will fulfill the purpose of your existence on earth in such a way that when you die, it will be the best day of yours. And this is why in one of the couplets, the poet says, O son of Adam, O son of Adam, when you came to this earth, when you were born, you came to this world crying, and those around you were smiling in happiness. They were overjoyed. So live your life in such a way that when you die, when you leave this world, you will be smiling, and those around you will be crying at the loss. أقول قولي هذا وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.